Hey, what's everyone? I'm Matt.
I'm Jace.
We're from Bullet of My Valentine.
And you're watching Bobby Me.
Hi, hey, I'm Anna. Nice to meet
Hello,
you.
I'm
cool. Yeah, so.
I'm
Patch?
Matt.
Okay. Not Matt. Okay, I'm Anna. So, this is your first time in Riga, right? In the Baltic States, you had a show last night in Vilnius, yes, in Lithuania. Tomorrow you are in Estonia. So, any first impressions of the region, of these cities? Have you actually had time to see anything?
Very clean.
Very clean.
I'm the only one that walks in the band. but beautiful. I love these places, you know, I love the history and the old towns, and that's just great, just feels at home, love it.
Do you usually get some time to actually see the places where you are, or it's just mostly venues?
Kind of do when you don't, you've got to really make the effort, you know, but it's hard when you're on tour because you're tired and mentally a little bit kind of drains. You've really got to drag yourselves out to go and see something, you know, so Jace is very good at doing that. I have been up today. I found a local gym, went to the gym, had a little walk around, got some noodles. So, you know, when I want to do it, I'll do it. But I'm quite lazy.
So, when I first heard your band name, Bullet for My Valentine, I thought, that sounds like a movie. So, what is the story behind the name?
There's no real story. We just wanted a name that was dynamic, something that was cool. Something which represented what the band was about and what the lyrics were about in the songs in the early days and stuff, and we just kind of stumbled upon that one night in the pub. So yeah, it wasn't like this deep meaningful thing, it was just, we were just brainstorming names and it came up. Yeah, and we love it.
So everybody voted for it?
Yeah, no, so as soon as we stumbled across it, it was like, wow, that's pretty cool. Kind of reminded us of like a Marilyn Manson kind of thing. It was kind of pretty but a bit dark and nasty, so.
So I want to take you a bit back to the moment when it all began. When was the moment that you kind of felt this connection with music, that you knew that you want to be a musician for the rest of your life?
For me, it was when I was around 14 and I discovered Metallica, really. And just kind of fell in love with the music, fell in love with that band in particular. Just made me want to pick up a guitar, so I did. Saved up as much money as I could, picked up a guitar, taught myself how to play, and then just started my musical journey of discovering bands and becoming a musician and wanting to be in a band myself. You know? Yeah.
Yes, and you?
Yeah, I come from a musical family, you know. Metal's always been in my family, as odd as that sounds. My dad was a massive Sabbath fan. Brothers play guitar, you know, surrounded by it. And I think, you know, growing up in a small village, there was nothing else to do really but hone my craft at playing drums. So yeah, you know, the rest is history, as they say, to coin a cliche.
And you've been in the music, industry for a very long time. And how would you say your perception of music and the way you see the music creating process, how has that changed?
I think the creative side of it hasn't changed at all. I think it's just wanting to be in a band, wanting to make and play music has always remained the same. And it's just letting that natural evolution of yourself as a person, as a musician, shine through, you know. I've always been a lover of rock, metal music, so that will always be what I do. But it's nice to, you know, let the stages of that commence, which we've been very lucky enough to actually be able to do. You know, we've done 6 records now, 6.5 including the debut EP, 7.5 including our little Axe Wound project a few years ago, and numerous collaborations and stuff. So it's good, you know, we're very lucky to have longevity. It's not something you think about when you're growing up and you have that, oh, it's our first record. That part of it's amazing, but I think being here 15 years later is even more amazing.
And for you?
Yeah, I think creating music, like Matt said, stay the same, but how it's presented and distributed has changed totally, which is quite strange when you think about it, because obviously we're doing nothing different than how we make an album, but from vinyl to CDs to now music streaming, it's massively different. And, you know, I personally champion music streaming because it just gets your music out to a wider audience, and nowadays it's all about live, really, you know, in terms of income and reaching fans and growing a new fan base, which is great because it's nice that things still have a organic essence to them rather than relying on reviews in magazines, which you just don't have to do anymore. It's all about the people that turn up to our shows, you know.
Straight to the source,
you know, and despite technology and people saying, oh, music stream is bad, you don't pay for music anymore. Well, it's, you know, it's always been about the live concert anyway, and we pride ourselves in our live shows. We work hard on them, you know. And yeah.
You released your latest album last year, and in that you kind of took a bit different path in regards to your sound. Was it like a more feel or think decision? Like, was it you thought that this is the time, we have been doing this way for some time, we think we need to change, or you felt like it, nah, it's kind of, we feel like this kind of urge to try something new? How was it?
I think it was feel and then think, because we did get together at the early stages of the writing process and we started to jump in the same old way of doing things, like really heavy guitar based stuff, which was great, you know, and it was sounding good. But for me personally, it just didn't feel challenging and it didn't feel exciting, which is the first time in like 20 years that it didn't feel exciting. It was like, this is weird, you know? So then we had a chat about it and, you know, they were quite difficult chats because a couple of the boys didn't really want to change that much. You know, everyone wants to evolve and have an album which is unique to the last, but obviously it's quite a bold, I don't know, step into the unknown what we've done, you know? And but I think we've done it really well, and I think ultimately what remains are great songs. You know, they're just presented and executed in a far different way than we've done in the past. And I think that's taken a lot of people by surprise, but it was something that we just wanted to do this time, you know, and it just kind of opens the door for the next record to be what that wants to be now. We don't have to stick to formulas anymore, you know, we just do what we feel is right kind of in here, you know, and that's what we've always done, really.
Do you kind of feel that this direction could be sort of also the path for the future, or you're kind of, let's see what happens?
There'll be parts of it which we've used on this record go into the next one. We won't kind of just like turn our back on this one now, you know. That's kind of how evolution works, you know. Some of it remains and some of it leaves, and then it comes around. And you know, we're lucky enough that we are quite a diverse metal band. We got a lot of I don't know, a lot of styles that we kind of use, and we've always mashed up. Even in the early days on The Poison, there's a lot of mashed up parts of different genres of metal and stuff, you know. It's just something we've always done. So I think, you know, having an album different from the last one really does lend itself to being able to do what we want again next time. You know, we don't want to get stuck in a routine of making the same style and same sounding records, because it just becomes a little bit boring, you know, and it's just not very challenging. And I think we wanted to challenge ourselves, and like, this was Jason's first album that he played on in full, and you know, he's one of the best drummers on this planet, and but the whole point is we're not exploiting those strengths, we're just trying to write great songs, you know. And should on the next record we want to unleash the full 4.5 liter V8 twin turbo version of him, we can, you know, because that's the beauty of it. You know, we have that in our arsenal. And it's just whenever we want to use it, we will, you know?
So I'm guessing you were on the board with everything that was going on, with the sound change, with everything.
I mean, you know, I saw it as such an exciting thing for me to be at my first Bullet album, and obviously was involved in Don't Need You, which came out previous October. But no, you know, the nice thing about playing on the album is I'm playing songs live now that I have a part in. You know, my favourite song off Gravity is Piece of Me, and that sort of epitomises part of my playing. It's kind of like an urban style groove, very heavy. And Gravity's, it's brought a Bullet into the modern day, I suppose, more contemporary. But I think it's in some ways heavier than anything the band's done, because the tunings are lower and the tempos are a little slower, but that's what makes it sound bigger and heavier live. And you know, when we reflect on the last year and a half, it's really not that different to the Bullet albums. And as far as electronics goes, you know, we've not smothered it in synths. There's like one sound on some of the songs. It's not really as crazy as people think.
Were you a bit concerned how your longtime fans are going to react to it? Because, you know, with bands who have been around as long as you have, it's usually the risk, okay, this is the band we know how it sounds, and suddenly it's different. Were you kind of a bit, you know, worried about that?
No.
Okay, cool, fair enough.
It's a curse. It's a curse, you know. You bring your first couple of albums out, the fans love you for what they are, but if you don't keep yourself excited, you're not going to keep the fans excited. And that's all it was at the time, Gravity. It was just trying to do something different.
Those first few albums, which are always kind of most people's favourites in any band, you know, when they're first discovered, they are written with the same thought process of not caring what people think, because no one knows who you are. So for us, it's like we go, our mentality is like, let's write the stuff that makes us excited and makes us want to get on a bus and a plane for 2 years and play the songs, not what we think people want to hear and write for them, and all of a sudden we don't like it and it hasn't worked, and all of a sudden it's just a bunch of crap that no one likes and no one's proud of, because we didn't do it for the right reasons. So you have to do it that way, you know? So it's not like we're not doing it for the fans because it's like a rebelling. It's we always do it for us anyways, and hopefully the fans love it as well. And if they don't, they don't, you know? But you can't win them all, you know? It's fine. It is what it is.
So, the interaction, live interaction with fans, that moment when you have just walked on stage, it's the first, you know, beat of the first song of the show. What goes through your head?
Just natural excitement, you know, because you would think touring for so many months of, you know, over 2 years, you'd get sick of it, and it does wear you down mentally, the traveling, but when you come out on stage and you see the excitement in people's faces, you realize how lucky and blessed you are to have such loyalty. You know, it's incredible. And people singing along, and get to the end of the set, we play Tears, and the roof raises, you know. So yeah, it's a privilege. It's a privilege.
Yeah, I think it's the same for me. It's like, there's a lot of time to kill on tour, and there are moments where it's like, oh my God, we have to play these songs again and this set list again. But for like the 128th show of the cycle is some people's first ever. You know, and that's the reason why we're here. So you have to perform it as if it's your first and your last gig you're ever gonna do. You know, and as soon as, like Jay said, as soon as the lights go out and you're tooled up and you walk out and you just hear like however many people, like 1,500 people here tonight, hopefully, you know, the roar goes, that's it, it's game face on, and it's go out and kill, it's destroy. It's time to have some fun, you know?
Obviously you have some hobbies probably at home more than rather than on road. What could we find on your playlist that is not
I don't listen to any rock music really. I'm listening to the Crystal Method at the moment, which is like electronic music and kind of cinematic stuff I love listening to. So yeah, you know, I mean, I watch a lot of Netflix, Handmaid's Tale. I love the theme music to that, and
Game of Thrones.
God.
Yeah.
I know, yeah, and I locked myself on the bus and watched the first episode, and yeah, it's nice to have those things to focus on, you know, when you're not on stage.
Yeah, I don't really listen to, like, immerse myself in music like I used to anymore. It's more about just keeping myself active mentally and physically. So I've been to the gym for 2 hours today just to get out of the venue, have a little walk around town and find some nice places to eat and stuff like that. So, but I just listen to the same music I've always listened to. It varies massively from metal to dance. So, you know, it's I think it's a good way to be.
If you could be an instrument, which instrument would you be and why?
Oh, probably a cello, because I like being tickled.
Okay. Oh my God, instrument, I have no idea. A guitar, because that's kind of what my life has been based around for so long that I couldn't think of anything else to be. You know, it's kind of, I am a guitar and he is drums. No, he gets beaten up on tour on a daily basis anyways.
So that's why you would want to be a cello.
Yeah, just so it's gently strummed.
Okay, and to end on a bit philosophical note, if you could change one thing and only one thing in the world, what would it be?
It'd have to be just palm oil. Just save the orangutans. You know, I'm just worried about the planet, and I think we're doomed, unfortunately.
Let's see how long we last.
Yeah. You know, care more about the environment. And spitting in streets, I hate it.
Yeah, it's not nice. for you?
I don't know. To pick one thing is massively too
hard. You have to.
then reverse the Brexit thing as a starter point, because it's just a complete utter shambles and a joke. So like, I'll start with that, and then I can go on to the rest of the world then. You know?
And you could get on with the orangutans and the spitting thing.
Get into the saving some monkeys.
Okay, well, thank you so much for chatting with us, and have a great show tonight and tomorrow. Okay, thank you.